So now it's next step. Let's have a look at finite length problems. And with finite length problems, I mean the following. So our DFT, yeah, if this is our index n, x, that's x of n, and we define our sequence only up to the point n minus 1, so that we have a sequence of n samples. Yeah, so if we have a signal here, then this signal will be just chopped off here at this point and stops. So the question is now, what is the impact on the frequency spectrum? Okay, let's have a look in octave. So let's pull octave here on the screen and create a vector t. T equals from 0 to, do we say, so it's step width of 1 and then 2 pi multiplied by 10, so that we have 10 revolutions here, and let's do a plot of the sign. So now we see here our sine wave here, so 10 peaks and 10 valleys here of that. Okay, so how does a frequency spectrum look like of this? So it's obviously easy. So we're doing a FFT of the sine wave, and then we're taking absolute value of this. So now we see these two peaks. Obviously we have a Fourier transform of a sine wave and we should see two peaks. So now the problem is, we see also here these side lobes. So we have a side lobe here and another side lobe here, and they shouldn't be there. So the question is now why this is happening. So why do we see these side lobes here? Let's just quickly draw this here on what we have seen here on GNUplot, just in a more cartoonish way. So if we have here our x of k, so what we see is something like that, yeah, so that we have some side wiggles here and then this here. So that's obviously our peak from the frequency, or our delta pulses generated by our sine wave. But now we've got these side lobes here. So let's tackle now the finite length problem analytically. So let's define this in the following way. So let's define a wave which is going on forever. Yeah, so let's call this wave here xn, and because it's running forever, xn infinity. So then, as a second bit, let's define something like a switch, which is switching the wave on for a certain period of time. Yeah, so that's 0 here and it's 1 here, and let's call this w of n. So this is creating a switch which is switching the wave on here. So if we continue down here, then we should see something like that. So when this just stays 0 outwards of the switch here, and let's just call this here xw of n. So the mathematical expression of this is obviously very easy. So xw of n is just x infinity of n multiplied by w of n. Yeah, we can do a Fourier transform of that, and let's just stay in the continuous space here, in the Fourier space, because that's just easier to tackle with this. So we define our x of xw here, and we use omega here, and then this is Then this is here x infinity of omega. And so now we know that a multiplication here turns into a convolution operation. So that's w of omega here. So that's now convolution. So now we just need to discuss what spectrum this here gives us, this spectrum here, and then we just convolve these two spectra with each other. So let's do that. So the spectrum of x infinity of omega is obviously pretty easy because that's just a delta function. So that's a delta function at frequency omega minus omega zero. So that's the frequency of our sine wave here. And we should not forget our mirror. So that's omega plus omega zero. So that's our mirror here. So we've got here again the frequency of our sine wave. Okay, so that's easy. So now the frequency spectrum of our window, yeah, so this is just like a step here of length L. This can be looked up, for example, Wikipedia or mathematical tables. So that's an omega, not a W, divided by 2, and then divided sine omega half multiplied by E2 minus J omega L minus 1 half. So now what we need to do is we just need to convolve these two functions with each other. So the convolution operation, remember, is defined here in the continuous space as x w omega. And then we have our x of infinity. So this one here. And we run this as is omega minus omega colon, that's our integration variable here, and then convolve this with the window of omega and do a d omega. So what's the result out of this here? Because we've got these two delta functions here, we're just simply getting this spectrum here at the locations where the delta functions are. Let's get an idea how this spectrum of our window function, our switch, looks like. Sine omega L divided by 2, and then sine of omega half, and then E2 minus J omega L minus 1 half. And so how does the spectrum look like this? So if we looking at the spectrum of this, then obviously this exponential term just goes away, and so our spectrum is just the absolute value of omega L divided by 2, and then the whole thing divided by sine of omega half. So that's our spectrum here. So our L in this case is just our sample width here. And so we can just plot this here just by creating a vector here running from minus pi to plus pi. So let's do that. So if we want to calculate the spectrum out of this, then
then this is the actual frequency spectrum what we're looking at. And so this gives us that, and the complex exponential is just one. So that's equals to one, so we don't need to deal with that. And then this one, as just mentioned on the previous slide, so our actual response towards the sine wave would be this one displaced to two places, omega minus omega zero, and then omega plus omega zero. And that's here this function omega just shows up twice in the spectrum, so that we have something like, so here center frequency, yeah, so that's omega, and that's the x omega of omega, and then here we have the center frequency around omega zero, and then this whole function here shows up here, so then we have something like that or so. And then we have the same on the side of minus omega zero. Again, we have got this function here, which then goes like that. So let's have a look if this actually is true, what I've calculated here, so that we just do it now with Python. So let's bring up fresh Python here. So again, we import NumPy as np, and we also import the matplot lib, because we need to have this to plot our result. So I just copy and paste this here over. So now we need to create the vector omega. So this omega here, these are angular values. So that runs up to pi and starts at minus pi. So we need to create a vector omega which is running from minus pi to plus pi. So let's bring this here back. Okay, so what we need to do is omega equals numpy linspace, that's this very convenient command, minus numpy pi, and then this runs to pi, and then we say we have 100 samples, so it's a length, then that we have 100 samples just looking at the different frequency samples here, so that we have a resolution here of 100 points just to look at this response. But we plot the omega only once, and then we can think of on the other side. Okay, so that's our vector omega. So it's running now from minus pi to plus pi, and so then we can now just plot this, plot PLT plot. I can just move this slightly to the side, that we see how the formula looks like. So that's our formula here. So that's sine. So sine is also part of numpy. So we've got the omega multiplied by the length, and we take there 100 divided by 2, and then we divide that here numpy sine, and then this is here just omega half. Now I just need to be careful with all the brackets here. So now, because it's a spectrum, we need to also look here at the absolute value. Well, let's just see how this looks like. Before I do that, just out of interest, yeah, so without the absolute value here, so we're getting these negative positive oscillations here, obviously, so the frequency response is just a positive of that, And so what we need to do is, so we just take the absolute value of this. And then it looks like that. Yeah, so then the side lobes here, these are the side lobes of this frequency response. Now just imagining these here on both sides. Yeah, so that one here and that one here. I'll just use the pen here. So we've got the side lobe, this one here on that side and on that side here. Okay, so that looks plausible. So now let's do the opposite. So let's try this out in not by analytical means, but that we're just doing the Fourier transform on a sine wave. So that's much more. So let's do that. Let's get rid of this here. So let's do get some scrap paper here. So let's start where we've started at the beginning of this playlist here. So we do a Fourier transform of a sine wave, and we do this in, of course, again in Python. So let's see. So if we do this Fourier transform of this sine wave here, and we are just creating these sharp edges here. And see if we are getting similar washed out response of our Fourier spectrum. Obviously in theory. So for infinite lengths, we would expect essentially in the frequency spectrum, if this is here f and this is here h of f, that we were just expecting one peak here, so essentially a delta peak. But here for our finite lengths, we are expecting that what I've just calculated analytically, that we're getting a broader spectrum here, which maybe looks like that. Yeah, so that this is here wider. So let's check if the practice matches the analytics. So test. Analytics is the same as matches the numerics, and we do this with the fast Fourier transform. Okay, so let's try that out. So let's bring Python back in here. So now what we need to do is we need to create a sine wave. And so t equals to numpy lin space. So let's create 10 sine waves. So 2 pi multiplied by 10. This gives us 10 sine waves, and we take 100 samples, the same what we have taken up here for L. So that's our temporal vector, and now we can plot this. PLT plot numpy ups of numpy FFT and then numpy sine, and then we just put the vector t in there. So we'll look, this is all right, yeah. So now we see here our Fourier transform of our sine wave. So the problem is the following now. So instead of having a beautiful delta pulse in the frequency domain, so if we have only one frequency here, so if this is here again omega and that's h of omega, so we don't have that, but in real life we have with finite lengths we have something like that, so that's washed out. So we have suddenly more than one frequency represented here. So that's here washed out, and so and this is usually called leakage. So leakage means that the actual frequency here, which is there, that's just leaking into the neighborhood here. So what solution is possible here? So the solution is very, very simple, and at least in terms of the intuition thereby. So the solution is, so don't do abrupt termination on start and stop of the signal. Yeah, so this means instead of having just this brick wall here where the sine wave just starts and oscillates and then it stops, so that's basically is bad. So we do the following, that this sine wave is slowly starting and getting bigger, and then at the end of that it's slowly tapering out. Yeah, so something like that. So we have we just need to have a smooth start and end of that. And so how do we do that in practice? In practice we just multiply our input function to our Fourier transform with the window function. So the solution, analytically or numerically is very simple. So imagine we've got again our brick wall enabled function here with these sharp edges here. Yeah, so that's our input signal here. And then we just multiply this with a weighting function, or how people call this, a window function. So for example, if this is here zero, with something like this. So we just multiply it, and then the result out of that is obviously something which is starting from zero. So if I try to do this, so we're starting here from zero, and then the sine wave slowly starts to oscillate here. Just give me some lines here to help me to get this here going. So that is starting from zero, and then it's oscillating here and oscillating, and then here at the end it goes back to zero. Yeah, so important here is that this is here again zero, and then this is here again also zero. So this one is here called window function. Window function. These window functions, there are a couple of functions available there, which are usually used. to standard one is called Hamming. Hamming window, and then there also the triangular window. Triangular window and Blackman is the so there are many more, but the general idea is that they're all smoothing out the edges and making then the response hopefully better. Yeah, so let's see what the effect of this is. So here we still have our response. So now it's very easy to add this because NumPy offers these window functions. Yeah, so if we just write something like NumPy dot Hamming, and then just say it wants to have the length obviously of the sequence. So now we just need to be careful with the brackets. Oops, that should be a star. Okay, so now we have here this smoothed out sine wave. So that's the original one. That's the one I've just multiplied with the Hamming window. So we see it starting smoothly at zero and then getting bigger and getting smaller again. So it's interesting that this should now basically fix our leakage here. So that's now easily done. So therefore, if I take here the whole function again and just copy our Hamming window in here, so that should be here. Oops, there was a bracket missing. And so now that's our frequency spectrum now here with the Hamming window applied. So if you compare this here with the original spectrum, then we see directly a massive difference here. So here we have the leakage here on this side, and now the Hamming window has made this completely flat here, just with some nice peak here going up here. It's obviously still, you know, a bit of leakage there, but it's much better than before, where we had this very smooth tailing off here to the sides. And so we see that the Hamming window makes a big difference in terms of the spectrum generated by the Fourier transform. So therefore, if you're plotting frequency spectra, it's recommended to use one of these windows just to make the display crisper and to avoid this leakage.